What you've heard is true. The Burning Crusade probably has the best set of dungeons released for any expansion. Now, that is a big claim, but one of the reasons why it's so true is the way these dungeons work as an endgame. Hello and welcome. I am Zabraxi. Keep in mind that today's video isn't specifically about dungeon design. Instead, we're going to be talking about how the 5-man instances of the Burning Crusade interact with the other systems in terms of endgame progression. Also, a quick interruption, I do stream over on twitch.tv/Zabraxi, so please feel free to stop by and say hello. And if you disagree with what I have to say in this video, let me know. It's always fun to chat. So without any more interruptions, let's go. I have been very openly critical about the Mythic Plus system in Modern WoW. It's not because I'm against it by any means. In fact, I'm actually all for something like this existing. My gripes mainly boil down to the implementation and its place within the progression of your character. M Plus is very lazy, especially when you compare its affixes and dungeon design to something like Guild Wars 2's Fractal of the Mist system, which fully accepts that affixes don't need to just be difficult, but they can also be engaging in other ways and also even be positive benefits or even just goofy. Also, as I just mentioned, my other main issue is where M Plus sits in terms of how players progress. It sits in this weird hybrid ground of being part of progressing into raid, serving as an alternative to raiding as an endgame, and is also infinitely repeatable. This ends up leading to Mythic Plus cannibalizing the raid scene in terms of rewards, and it has for years, which could be honestly a whole video in and of itself, as Blizzard has made countless systems lately that actively harm other systems in the game. Come Shadowlands, Blizzard decided to shift raiding into having more power in terms of gear again, and the player base quickly realized how superficial M Plus suddenly was. Again, my point in bringing this up isn't to trash talk the Mythic Plus system, since I'd actually love to see it succeed, but this convention of Blizzard's new systems tending to invalidate others is something that the Burning Crusade escaped with the introduction of heroic modes. By the end of vanilla, many players were commenting about how trivial dungeons had become. People wanted something harder. They wanted a bit more challenge. They really wanted to have something leave their mark on the masses. Come Outland, Blizzard would introduce heroic mode, an increased difficulty available to each and every dungeon. There are two major things that Blizzard did to ensure that dungeons could now serve as an additional layer to the endgame without invalidating it. Well, actually, there are many more than two, but in terms of heroic additions, specifically, there's two that I want to look at. First, heroics aren't infinitely scalable. Their finite end ensures that they are but a step on the ladder and don't risk becoming the ladder itself. Second, there's a barrier to entry to heroic dungeons that almost guarantees you'll need to enter normal modes at least once before stepping foot into heroic. This presents contextualization to the activity, as you can now feel the growth as the player. Also, since heroics need a key, and that key required revered originally, the normal mode dungeon scene was always active, even for ults, so a limited two-tier difficulty never really ran dry, despite being a essentially smaller scaling of Mythic Plus. As heroics are also only level 70 versions, then your normal mode experience can stay interesting during your leveling experience. And then, upon 70, you'll still be entering the regular version of the instance in order to obtain items for heroic progress, to finish quests, or to gather reputation, to even be able to get the key into heroics, or, most importantly, to set you up for that Karazhan attunement. A good way to think about this is that the attunement process is like the spine of the Burning Crusade. Everything else, all the other activities and systems, kind of branch out like a nervous system. So as we move forward, keep that in the back of your mind. Back. My puns are so bad, I don't even write them in anymore. Gearing in TBC continues along a common trend of vanilla. It's mostly a linear path up into and through raiding, with the occasional dungeon drop or crafted item filling in some holes. However, Burning Crusade is a bit more clever. Heroic dungeons might not always drop pre-raid best in slot items, though they very much can, but it also drops supplemental items in regards to the other systems. What this means is that different gearing mechanics can synergize with heroics, and the two don't cannibalize each other. For example, the Scryer's Blood Gem is notoriously powerful, and it's a key player into why someone might pick Scryer over Aldor, especially if you're a caster DPS. It's also a reputation reward at Revered, so the Blood Gem kind of double dips as being a reward tied to reputation while also being tied to the Aldor Scryer faction system. All in all, the Scryer's Blood Gem should stay unique and powerful. Well, Heroic Old Hillsbrad drops the Arcanist Stone. This has less hit rating, but a more powerful unused proc for caster DPS, but only slightly. Without question, the hit rating is the most useful element of both of these trinkets, so Blizzard intelligently created a competitive item to Blood Gem without ever eclipsing it. This dance in gearing is just one way gearing in Heroic stays relevant without being too powerful. Many casual players will be engaging in the Heroic grind as their end game, and being able to respect the other gear sources helps validate a player's investment across all sorts of activities. Now, some of you might be rightfully questioning, how in the world can Heroics be considered an endgame when even Karazhan has mostly better gear? Well, we all know how powerful those crafted items are, right? The profession system in TBC is most likely the strongest it's ever been in terms of a craftable's raw power. Probably the first video that ever did well on this channel actually went over their power specifically, so hey, I mean, feel free to check that one out. It's doing pretty good, I appreciate it. Something I didn't mention in that video, though, is that in order to obtain something as potent as the Spell Strike could, you need this little thing called a Primal Nether. These babies have a very low drop chance from the final boss of a normal dungeon, but have a guaranteed drop from the final boss of Heroics. However, it's only one drop per, and it's a bind on pickup. These primals will be contested, and their value will be fascinating to watch when Classic TBC is out. If you would like to be able to make some items that are better than some of the tier 4 pieces, then you will be doing Heroics for these Primal Nether. This is yet another way in which Heroics can feed into another endgame system, this time professions, which have some incredible potential in terms of crafting some powerful items, and yet doesn't invalidate the entire raid scene. Okay, yeah, some of the tailoring recipes might be a bit too strong, but you get the idea. Let's say you're not very lucky and you can't seem to get one of these pesky Primal Nether to drop, though. Well, have no fear. Your bad luck can be sorted by the badge vendor. Yes, you will obtain badges of justice along your way through Heroics, and you can spend 10 of your badges to grab a Primal Nether to make your crafting gear possible. Granted, you'll need loads more of the other primals in order to craft most of these items, but at least the Nether is out of the way. I've done a full video about how badges of justice also fit into this whole structure, so if you're curious, check that one out too. That'd be awesome. I've mentioned Karazhan several times now, and it's because the attunement questline is just, it's so beautifully interwoven with the dungeon experience. And Heroics, they don't just test your mettle. They don't just test that you're worthy to enter raiding. No, they also allow you to even step into the dungeon with the key and to be able to unlock it if you do ever decide to take that plunge. And it's a pretty deep plunge. The Karazhan attunement is a masterpiece in design. On one hand, it's an overwhelming checklist that would freak most people out. On the other hand, it's a brilliant roadmap, a hand to hold you through this insane amount of dungeons available. The questline to enter the 10-man raid directs the players through dungeons in a structured manner that I can only sum up as genius. In most MMOs, players will ask what to do next, and then what, and then what, and then what. Honestly, it's rather annoying for everybody involved when that confusion exists, but in TBC, things can be summed up so easily. You're max level and you're not sure what to do beyond this for gear progression? Well, go start the Karazhan attunement. Easy. Like, seriously, that's it. That questline will set you into motion, and along the journey, you'll explore many of the dungeons and their heroic versions, which will get you geared and ready to step into the wonderful world of raiding if you so desire someday. If not, and you're more of a casual player, then the Karazhan attunement and the heroics in turn will provide you possibly with weeks, if not maybe months of progress to be made on this one quest chain alone. Along that path, you'll gear up, you'll make progress, maybe gather some Primal Nether, which you can use to check out the profession items, which will also get you into the world as well as the instances. To unlock Heroics, you'll need to get keys, and to unlock certain dungeons in general will involve either quest lines or reputation rewards to help explore the world and the lore and provide even more to do. While this video isn't about the Kara attunement specifically, its interwoven interaction with the Heroic dungeon grind allows for players to progress through the PvE endgame of Outland. From the casual to the hardcore, Heroic dungeons are an endgame in and of themselves. Well, it's that time. It's time to hit that thumbs up and subscribe button if you want to watch more of my stuff. And thumbs down if you thought that this was a very lame way to try to get you to hit those buttons. You know, I just got to do what I can. Got to give it a shot. Also, please don't forget to follow me on Twitch and Twitter, where I live stream Classic WoW, and, you know, variety gaming will be coming as well to the side if people are interested. So that'll be fun. And Twitter, where I spout all my other gaming nonsense and opinions on things. So I appreciate you all for watching. If you agree or disagree, please let me know in the comments down below, and I'd love to have the chat. That's it for me, though. I'll see you all in the next one. Bye-bye!